met a man named Lord Henry Wotton at Bezel's studio. What delightful ideas he had of beauty and human nature. He was simply splendid. Of course, Bezel's masterpiece of myself was the highlight of the day. I am stunning. Nothing can compare to my beauty. Before my eyes were opened, I simply thought Bezel's compliments were merely the exaggeration of his friendship. Now I see the truth in his words. I feel the painting is a part of myself. I would give my soul to preserve it.
You have sat splendidly today. It is finished. Don't you like it?
Of course he likes it. It is one of the greatest things in modern art. I will give you anything for it. I must have it.
It is not mine. It belongs to Dorian.
How sad it is I shall grow old and horrible and dreadful, but it will always be young. If only it were the other way. If only I was to always be young and the picture grew old and disfigured. There is nothing I would not give. I would give my soul.
I am glad you appreciate it. It is yours. Do with it as you wish.
I was determined to find some adventure. I found it in a little absurd theater run by a hideous Jew. Sybil Vane stepped onto the stage and my world exploded with color.
Although I joy in thee, I have no joy of this contract tonight. It is too rash, too unadvised, too sudden, too like the lightning which doth cease to be, ere one can say, it lightens. Sweet good night. This bud of love by summer's ripening breath may prove a beauteous flower when next we meet.
I watched Sybil's performance again last night. She was simply divine. Her exquisite beauty and delicate grace outshone any others on stage. She is a born artist. When it was over, we spoke and kissed. Our engagement is secret, for I know my guardian shall be furious. Tonight, Lord Henry and Bezel shall accompany me to see her. Surely, they shall admit her talent.
Thou knowest the mask of night is on my face, else would a maiden blush repaint my cheek. For that which thou hast heard me speak tonight.
She is quite beautiful, Dorian, but she can't act. Let us go.
No, I must see it through. I am awfully sorry that I have made you waste an evening. I apologize.
We shall come another night.
She is completely altered. Last night she was a great artist. Now she is merely a commonplace.
Don't talk of someone you love like that. Love is more than art.
They're both forms of imitation.
Go away, Harry. I want to be alone.
Let us go, Bezel.
Horrible. It was horrible. Simply dreadful. Are you ill? I too suffered.
You should have understood. I thought you would. Surely you understand now, don't you?
Understand what?
Why I was so bad tonight. Why I shall always be bad. Why I shall never act well again.
You are ill, I suppose. You should not act when you are ill. You make yourself ridiculous. My friends were bored. I was bored.
Before I knew you, acting was the one reality in my life. It was only in the theater that I lived. I thought it was all true. I was Rosalind one night and Portia the next. The joy of Beatrice was my joy, the sorrows of Cordelia with mine also. I believed everything. The painted scenes were my world. You came, my beautiful love, and you freed my soul from prison. You taught me what reality is. Tonight, for the first time in my life, I became conscious that Romeo was hideous and old and painted, and the words I had to speak were unreal, were not my words, were not what I wanted to say. You made me understand what love really is. I have grown sick of shadows. You're more to me than all art can ever be. When I came tonight, I thought it was going to be wonderful. I found I could do nothing. Suddenly it dawned on my soul what it meant. Even if I could do it, it would be a profanation for me to play at being in love.
You have killed my love. I loved you because you were marvelous, because you had genius and intellect, because you realized the dreams of great poets and gave shape to the shadows of art. You have thrown it all away. You are shallow and stupid. How mad was I to love you? You are nothing to me now. I will never see you again. I will never think of you. I wish I had never laid eyes upon you. Last night I was perfectly horrid to my dear Sybil. Her eyes had been opened to the love and life, and her acting then seemed frivolous and devoid of feeling. How ridiculous and dreadful she was. Nonetheless, I know my callous cruelty was unwarranted. The painting made me see my treatment of her was unjust. I planned to make amends, but Lord Henry brought me news of her apparent suicide before I could act on them. I am relieved. I shall consider myself lucky. I no longer must face what I have done. It is to be forgotten.
I am sorry, Dorian, but you must not think too much about it.
You mean Sybil Vane?
Yes, it is dreadful, but it was not your fault. Did you see her when the play was over?
Yes.
I knew you would. Did you make a scene?
I was perfectly brutal, Harry. But it is all right. I am not sorry. It has taught me to know myself better.
Ah, I am glad you take it that way. I was afraid of the state I would find you in.
I am perfectly happy now. I know what my conscience is. It is the divinest thing in us. I want it to be good. I can't bear the thought of my soul being hideous.
I congratulate you, but how are you going to begin?
I'm marrying Sybil Vane.
But Dorian, didn't you get my letter?
Yes, but I have not opened it yet.
Then you are unaware?
What do you mean?
My letter was to tell you Sybil Vane is dead.
Dead? It cannot be. It is a horrible lie.
It is quite true. It is in all the papers. You must not be mixed up in the inquest, of course. One should never debut with a scandal.
Harry, an inquest? Be quick. Tell me everything.
I have no doubt it was not an accident, but it shall be told that way. They found her lying on her dressing room floor. She had swallowed some dreadful thing that they use at the theaters.
So I have murdered Sybil Vane. Murdered her as surely as if I cut her throat with a knife.
You must not feel responsible. You must simply think of that lonely death as a strange fragment of some Jacobean tragedy. Don't waste your tears over Sybil Vane.
Lord Henry sent me a book properly to distract me. It is a jewel book of the life of a Parisian exploring the passions and modes of thought of other centuries, including what men call virtue and sin. It has fascinated me most greatly. It has been quite some time since I've written in this diary. I have been taken with many things, including perfumes, jewels, music, religion, and tapestries. I am still afraid that someone shall uncover my secret. I came across across Basil Hallward in the street last night. I passed him, hoping he would not recognize me. Sadly, he did. He told me he was concerned with all the rumors and scandals surrounding my name. He wanted to see my soul, the soul he himself created and that would tell him the truth. He wanted me to explain the charges laid at my feet, so I showed him his painting, the painting that has destroyed me forever. Now, he's upstairs dead, sitting amid a pool of his own soiled blood. What is this all about?
It is about yourself. And I must say, I think you should know the most dreadful things are being said of you in London.
I love scandals of other people, but those about myself don't interest me.
They must interest you, Dorian. You don't want people to talk of you as something vile and degraded. Mind you, I don't believe these rumors. I can't when I see you. Sin writes itself across a man's face. But with you, your pure, innocent face, and your marvelous youth, I can't believe against you.
Stop, Basil. You know not what you speak of.
Your name was implicated in the most terrible confession, but I know you are incapable of anything of the kind. But I should have to see your soul to truly know.
You shall see it tonight. Come, it is your own handiwork. Now you shall look upon it face to face. You insist on knowing?
Yes.
I am delighted. You are the one man in the world who is entitled to know everything about me. You think only God can see the soul. Well, here is mine.
Oh my! What does this mean?
It is the face of my soul.
Pray, Dorian. That is the only thing. We must pray.
It is too late, Basil.
It is never too late.
The people are still discussing poor Basil's disappearance.
I should think they would be tired of that by now.
Only been talking about it for 6 weeks.
What do you think happened?
I have not the slightest idea. If he chooses to hide, that is his business. If he is dead, I do not want to think of it.
Did it ever occur to you that Basil was murdered?
Why should he have been murdered? He was not interesting enough to have enemies.
What if I told you I murdered him?
I would say you are posing for a character that does not suit you. It is not in you to commit a murderer.
I recently talked with Lord Henry about Basil's sudden disappearance. He could not believe I could kill another man. I am too beautiful. How wrong he is. I killed Basil for the wrong he did to me, yet I still have no peace. The painting is my conscience. It is the last evidence of my wrongdoings. Surely if I destroy it, it can no longer torment me. The knife that killed the painter shall also kill his works. It shall erase the awful memories of the past. Then, I shall be allowed to live in peace.